can't hear as well, or something's wrong with its vocal cords. So the whale is a lonely whale, and it has inspired actually a lot of artists besides me. There's a documentary coming out at the end of this year about, actually Leonardo DiCaprio started a Kickstarter campaign to fund this documentary, and they're looking for the 52 hertz whale in the documentary. And then it's also inspired some musicians as well, one of which, I'm gonna play some music for you from these musicians. And Chloe, if you want, Kyla, if you want, you can sit down. Don't feel like you have to stand there. Go ahead, sit down, because this will take a minute for me to queue up. So one of the musicians, the first musician we're gonna listen to is here we go. It's a Korean rap song. Get ready, everyone. The first part is in English, and then it goes to Korean. So, and I'm gonna try and turn it off before it becomes explicit, but here we go. One artist who's been inspired by the whale other than me, and I got one more for you. This one's totally different. This is Colin Stetson. He's actually a saxophonist, so here we go. So that gives you kind of an idea. Oh, here it is. This is the actual song. So you can see how that kind of has a whale feeling to it too, of a lonely whale. And I just wanted to share those because I think it's really interesting how artists get inspiration from the same thing, and it takes so many different forms. I mean, could those two pieces of music be any different? And yet they were both inspired by the 52 hertz. So I think that that's a pretty cool thing. So next up, we've got Emily. Emily? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Emily. And what kind of research did you conduct in order to write this book?
I did do a lot of research on the book. I had to obviously do a lot of research on whales, also on the 52 hertz whale. And I also did some research on Asperger's syndrome. While we don't explicitly say that James has Asperger's syndrome, I just wanted to get an idea of what life would be like from the perspective of somebody who had that, so that I could put some of those tendencies into James's behavior. And so I looked at some blogs and some research by psychologists, things like that, to build that into James's character. And I love research, so for me, research is often the starting point and kind of propels my interest in writing a book. So even the part about shells, and for those of you that read the book, I was really fascinated in learning about shells and including that piece into the book as well. So I'm a nerd, I did research, so it was fun for me. Thanks, Emily. Cool glasses, by the way. All right, we got Robert.
Hi, your name is Natalie.
Hey, how are you?
I'm people today. So you kind of already answered that question, but I said, why did you decide to use an email exchange as the format for the novel? And then what challenges did that present to you as a writer?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And I can talk a little bit about what challenges it presents, because it definitely, that was an amazing question. It does present a lot of challenges, because when you're writing an email to somebody, there's a lot of information that you know that you actually don't need to write in the email, but that you need the reader to know. So it was difficult sometimes when Bill and I were writing back and forth. I'd think, oh man, I really need the reader to know that that James's dad is kind of hard on him about sports, but how do I get that in there without making it sound like I'm planting the information? How do I make it feel natural? And that's one of the challenges of email. The other thing was, too, is that we wrote in real time. So if Bill didn't get back to me for 3 weeks, that date was the date that had to be on my response to him in the email. So sometimes I was like, why didn't James write to him for 3 weeks? It was kind of hard, but it was one of the conditions of our game of writing these emails back and forth. So it's interesting, because for the writing process, about halfway through, we realized, you know, like I said, we realized, hey, this could be something, this could be a story, but we didn't really know if it would be a novel. At that point, we started plotting out the rest of the novel. And for writing, people tend to either be plotters or pantsers. So in other words, a lot of writers either write and plot first and then write, or they just go by the seat of their pants, hence the pantsers. And I guess Bill and I, in this novel, we were really pantsers. We were kind of just writing for the fun of it. But halfway through, we really did need to plot, because at some point, you really need to make sure that the characters and the ideas and the themes that you have are coalescing. So, awesome question. Thank you so much. So now we've got Alyssa.
Hi, my name is actually Heather. Alyssa isn't here, so I'm.
Oh, great! Hi, Heather.
Hi. Why did you choose to have a teenage protagonist interact with an older mentor in the book?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, Bill actually chose the age of his character, and Darren is definitely, he's a mentor to James, but I also feel like in the end, James really helps Darren as well quite a bit. So I kind of see them switching roles a little bit in the end, because Darren has to come to grips with his life without Corinne in it. I'll give you a little bit of background about Darren. A lot of Darren's interests are actually some of Bill's interests. Bill is actually involved in film writing. He wrote a comedy called Tony Tango, so if you're interested, you can YouTube it and see the trailer and stuff. It's a really funny movie. He also is an awesome drummer, and I don't think he brought drumming into this novel, but he's in a band and he does drumming. He's written about drumming in the second novel into one of his characters. So I think that the older character also is was interesting to include in a YA novel, because, you know, I think the 20s is a time of your life where you're trying to figure a lot of stuff out, and we just really wanted to experiment with having somebody in the novel who was still trying to figure stuff out, and yet at the same time trying to give advice to somebody younger than him, when, you know, this older guy hasn't even figured his life out. So, and I'm still figuring my life out, and I'm in my 30s, but I mean, you know, I think that that's a really interesting dynamic too. So we wanted to play with that one as well. Yeah, so thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, let's see, Libby.
Hello.
Hi.
Can you just describe the process of writing a book with a partner, and what are some of the challenges and rewards of co-authoring a book?
Yeah, so that's an awesome question. Mostly because most people do not co-author books. As you probably noticed, most people write by themselves, and writing is a lonely process when you're writing by yourself. You don't have somebody to bounce ideas off of, and mostly it's just you and your computer or you and the books that you're reading to do research. So for me, I saw a lot of upsides in writing with someone. It was definitely more social. If Bill and I had questions, we would just email each other outside of our ongoing email communications as Darren and James. And so oftentimes, you know, especially during the process of when we were getting the book published, as debut novelists, there was a lot about that process that was challenging for us to navigate. You know, first we got the offer to have the book bought, and we were so excited, and so it was nice to have somebody that I could text and say, oh my God, you know, somebody wants to buy this book, and he was equally as excited. So that was really fun, and then choosing an agent was also another difficult, you know, process. There's so many great people out there, and it was nice to be able to have Bill with me to kind of vet the people that would be representing our book going forward. So it was really fun to have him for all of that. And I think I can't really even think of many downsides. I guess sometimes he would give me feedback and maybe I didn't like what he said as his feedback, but I feel like that's the process of being a writer anyway, is you get a lot of, and you guys probably experienced this in school, when your teachers give you feedback on your writing, sometimes you don't always agree with what they say or maybe even the grade you got, right? But it can help you become better as a writer. And I actually have here, this is another manuscript I'm working on, but hopefully you can see it. Some of it's in pencil, but there's like just tons of comments all over it. And this is a critique that somebody wrote for me on the back about all their ideas of how I can change and make my second novel better. So as much as writing really is solitary, there's definitely a collaborative piece where you're getting feedback and you're getting critiques from other writers to make your work better. And so having that built in with Bill was pretty awesome. And I didn't really know Bill that much in school. I mean, we have these things called workshops as writers in school where people read our writing and give us feedback. And I remember thinking sometimes in those workshops, like, wow, Bill is really harsh on my writing. Like, I didn't really know him that well. I just knew, like, boy, that guy can be a little harsh. So I think that was good in a way because it challenged me. Every time I wrote an email to Bill, I wanted it to be perfect because I didn't want to hear the bad feedback. So, and I think he kind of did the same to me. And in a way, he would almost write my character into a tough spot, and then I would write his character into a tough spot. So I think that was kind of helpful in the long haul for the book and added tension to the book. So thank you so much. Awesome question. Let's see. Jacob.
Sorry, I had to come through for Rogue, but I'm here.
Yeah, no problem.
So other than 52 Hertz Whale, I guess this could apply to any of your stories that you've written. What goes into your writing process other than, you know, revision through other authors?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And, you know, I realize many of you probably won't end up being writers, but I'll tell you a little bit about what my day's like and how I feel like writing is used in almost any profession that you're gonna do. So for me, my day starts, I have two little kids, one that's 3.5 and one that's 1.5. So my day kind of starts with changing diapers and getting them ready to go out. And my babysitter comes and the first thing that I need is coffee. So I run to the coffee shop. They know me there. A lot of them, know my book and will ask me about my second book and what's going on with that. So that's super fun. Then I head off to the library, and a lot of the first part of my working is looking at what I've written previously and making small edits to it or large edits, and then I try and start generating new work as much as I can. Interestingly, if you like to read, a lot of the work of a writer is also reading. Reading teaches me how to handle certain aspects of my own work. So if I need to write a scene with dialogue and I'm really struggling, I'll look at somebody who's a novel by somebody who is really good at writing dialogue to try and get ideas. So that's kind of also a hint for any of you who like to write, like imitate what you see your favorite authors doing, because that will help you learn and will help you become better at writing setting or character, whatever it is you're trying to work on. So that's kind of a basic day for me, but I do need to get feedback also a lot from people, as I mentioned. And my husband's actually trained as a lawyer, but he does a ton of writing in his work. It's very different from mine, obviously. But he's actually my beta reader. He's the first person that I give my manuscript to. And I feel like he is very good at giving feedback and often sees things, even though he's not a fiction reader, actually, he likes nonfiction better. He often sees things in my work that I don't see, which is very helpful. But I guess I just want to make the plug here. I also am a teacher. I teach writing at the university level and do some little things like that to make money, because contrary to what most people believe, writing is not a really lucrative, often job, and so I supplement my income also with teaching and editing things, and sometimes even tutoring as well. So that's kind of and I feel like most writers have some other jobs, even really successful writers like Joyce Carol Oates. Some of you might be familiar with her work. She's a teacher. I mean, most writers do supplement their income teaching or editing or doing some other kind of work. It also fuels, to read students' work really fuels your own imagination and helps you think about your work critically, so that's really good as well. The last thing I would say about like a typical writing day, and just a plug for any of you in anything that you do, writing is so essential. I feel like now more than ever that we're all on computers and so much of our work is done on computers, you need to be a good writer, right? Even if you're writing an email or if you're going out and fixing somebody's pipes and then you need to make a report, like you need to be able to write. So as much as you can practice that skill and try and get better at it and learn from and read, I mean, I've got to make the plug for it. It's important now today more than ever. So thanks for an awesome question. Thank you. All right, now we've got, I hope I say your name right, Riley? Beautiful name too.
Can you tell us a little bit about what you're working on next?
Yes, I can. Thank you for asking. So I'm going to put a picture here. I hope you guys can see it. This is my, I'll try and get it a little closer. This is my grandma. She's right here and right here. She was born in, both my grandparents were actually born in Castiglione Messer Marino, which is a place in Italy, and it's in a region called Abruzzo, which is on the Adriatic coast. She was born in a really rural part of Italy, not like Rome. Has anybody been to Italy out there? Anybody? No? Okay, one person, great. So it's not like Rome, it's not very urban at all, it's pretty rural. And she actually lived through World War II as a person about your age. And so my second novel is inspired by her experience living through World War II, and also my great aunt as well. And I don't think that there's a lot of work out there on what life was like for civilians during World War II, because what happened is Italy was on, as most of you have probably studied in your history classes, Italy was on one side of the war fighting with the Germans, then they switched sides and they were fighting with the Allies and the Americans. Well, the Germans were in Italy fighting with Italians, and then when the Italians became the Germans' enemies, the Germans were obviously angry, and so there were a lot of things that happened, horrible things that happened to Italian civilians as the Germans retreated across the continent. So that's kind of a little bit of the basis for the story. Also, my great-grandfather was a goldsmith, and in our culture, we believe that that jewelry has healing powers, and different shapes of different amulets have different healing powers. And so there's a lot of magical realism in my second book around the magic that is inside of jewelry, or that Abruzzese believe is inside the jewelry. So that's my next novel, and I was actually very lucky to receive an award that's given to 6 women writers every year in the nation, and I was flown out to New York for that, and then I received $30,000, which was a very nice grant to receive, and with that, I'm going to be heading out to Italy, actually a week from today, so to do some research, so I'm really excited. Thank you so much for that awesome question.
Hey, excuse me. My name is Romeo Spells. I don't know if I'm not on your list, but I have a question.
No, you are! Romeo! Yes, you are! You are actually my first guy! Yes!
Awesome. So, do you mind if I ask you a quick question? And there's also one more person who got skipped over. Her name is Michaela. Can she come up after? Okay, cool.
Yes, awesome. Perfect.
Anyway, so you talked a little bit about it, but could I have you go more in depth about like how you began your career as a writer? You know, what are some of your inspirations, favorite authors, favorite books, things along that?
Sure, yeah. So I would say for me, how I became an author, one thing I'll talk about now is just how you have to persevere as a writer. So I started writing my second novel in 2008, and I'm still working on it. So, and it's gone through probably 36 drafts. So, and for me, how I started my career is I started trying to get things published in regional magazines. So magazines that were particular to Illinois, particular to Chicago, and then I moved to more national magazines and more national awards. So that's also a hint for anybody out there who thinks they might want to be a writer, either a journalist or a creative writer. You know, start small. There are magazines out there that publish high school students' work. I know Yarn is one of them, Y-A-R-N Review. They're a great one. But there are lots of magazines out there that need to publish people in a certain geographical area because of where they receive their funding. So I kind of started at that level of publishing, and as I built more credits, I was able to publish at a more national level. So that's a little bit about that. And I would say now one of my huge inspirations now, has anybody read Anthony Doerr's book, All the Light We Cannot See? Do you like it? Thumbs up or thumbs down? Yes, amazing book. It's an amazing book. And I would encourage those of you who liked it to check out his short story collections too. He wrote The Shell Collector, and it's that's actually the book that I was most familiar with when I was beginning my career, and I was just blown away by his work. He, like me, likes to incorporate a lot of research into his fiction, and so that's totally inspirational to me when I'm reading a novel or a short story and I'm also learning about something, and he's really good at kind of braiding those two things together. So, awesome question. Thank you, Romeo.
Hello, my name is Michaela. I just wanted to ask a quick question. You've been like giving suggestions the whole time, but like, what are some more suggestions that you have for students who like to write?
Yes, I actually made some notes on this too. I would say, first of all, read a lot, read as much as you can, and then see those authors that you love as your mentors. And they're the people that you want to start copying and imitating. And I don't mean that like plagiarizing. I mean like you look at their work, you see how they're creating a character, how they're moving plot along, what strategies they use, and then start incorporating that into your own work. Another great thing to do is if you guys have a bookstore or a coffee shop in town, they probably have readings. Or authors who come and read from their work, or maybe even open mic nights, where if you're a poet, you can come and read poetry, your poetry, or do spoken word. You know, that's really important to kind of become part of the literary scene and go and listen to what other writers locally are doing. And then I would say find a writing group or make one, you know, like, if you know one of your friends at school likes to write, try what Bill and I did. Become characters and start writing back and forth to each other. Guarantee you will write a story that way. If you like find a friend and just start writing back and forth as characters, you will make a story. But try this. Try not telling each other what's going to happen. Just do what Bill and I did. Write back and forth and see what happens. I would say the other thing is just to, like I said before, persevere. It took me 8 years writing before I got a novel published. And a lot of people give up, and you gotta just keep going as a writer. You gotta kinda get a thick skin, because you're gonna have, if you do get published, you're gonna have people reviewing your work at a national level and telling the whole world what they don't like about your work and what they do like about your work, and it's hard, you know? So you gotta get a thick skin. And then the last thing I would say is just to believe in your art and believe in your message. Because you're gonna have editors and agents telling you to change things. You're gonna have critics who don't like what you've written or aspects of your work. And you've gotta, in the end, art and making art is for yourself, and you've got to keep that in mind and really love what you're writing about. So that's what I would say, and just keep at it, keep practicing it as much as you can. Are you a writer?
I write in my creative writing class. Like, we write a lot of short stories and stuff like that. Yeah.
That's awesome. You guys have a creative writing class. That's amazing. Great. Good for you guys. That's really great that's offered. That wasn't offered at my school in high school. I would have been all over it. Great. Thanks for the question. How are we doing on time?
We probably have about 10 minutes left. So
okay.
I have one more quick question about the book, and then anything else you want to share would be great. You mentioned
sure.
How you and Bill kind of alternated characters back and forth between James and Darren. Eventually, the novel opens up and we start getting emails from other characters. How did you decide that you wanted to do that with the book, take it beyond just those two? And then what was your writing process then, since each of you were writing as one of those main characters? How did you split up the new characters you added?
Yeah, that's a great question. And actually, and it brings me to how we actually got the book published. We submitted the manuscript, what we had for the manuscript. It was a complete arc. We had the whole plot, but many of the minor characters that you see were missing from what we submitted. We submitted it to a call by an editor and a publishing company for unagented manuscripts, which meant at the time we did not have an agent. It was kind of a lark. We didn't even know if it would get picked up. And Andrew Carr wrote back to us within a month and said, "Have you sold this book?" We couldn't believe it. We really wanted to work with him. And He was actually, I bring that up because he, our editor, was actually the one that wanted to see more of the minor characters involved. He's a musician, and as I mentioned, Bill's also a musician. And so he saw the story as a fugue. He wanted there to be lots of voices, and he thought that kind of the unanswered emails, some of the unanswered emails and some of the stories that kind of cut off without us knowing the ending, replicate modern loneliness and like how we're really trying to connect with people through our modern means of communication, like Skype or like email, and sometimes not getting that personal connection that we want. So what we did then is Bill took all of the minor characters that were related to Darren in some way, and I took all of the minor characters who were related to Sophia in some way, or I'm sorry, James in some way. So like Sophia, if you've read the book. And that was super fun to include all of the minor characters and start getting their voices in there as well. But I wanted to bring up the part about the business of publishing. So the editor is basically giving us feedback and we're incorporating it. But I also wanted to bring that up to show those of you who are interested in grammar, but not just grammar, like critiquing how a piece actually looks. I'm sure you guys do some peer workshopping. It sounds like if you have a creative writing class, if you're that person who likes to give advice to somebody else on their writing, you might consider being an editor. You might consider being a copy editor if you really like grammar. We had to work with a lot of different people on this book. We had to work with an editor. We had a marketing team. We had an agent whose role was to sell the book. So if you're interested in sales and you love books, you might think about being an agent. Move to New York, be an agent. Or Chicago has lots of agents are actually everywhere now, so you can really work anywhere and be an agent. So that was a great question, though. Thank you so much. And actually, I do want to let you guys know, too, there's a, and I can send the link to this, there's a story that I wrote from Sophia's point of view that was just published in March. On Yarn, the magazine I was referring to earlier. So I can send that to you and you can hear a little bit more. This is almost a prequel to the book. It's what happened to Sophia when her dad died. So I'd love to share that with you guys as well for those of you that are interested. Any other questions people have? Anybody? Yeah. Come on up.
Hey, hello, back again.
Okay. Yeah.
So I don't write as much as I once did. Now the school's picking back up. But one thing that I used to struggle with was like developing characters, you know, giving them their own lives and this separate reality that I've created. So what is that like? Like, could you explain the process of getting to know a character, creating a character, and giving them life to make them, you know, identifiable to your audience?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I can tell you're a writer because you talk like a writer and you understand our language. So it's I think for me, one of the ways I get to know my characters often is people have all different ways of getting to know characters. One way that you can think about is, and this I can send a link to your teacher to as well, is do a character inventory. So this is where it's almost like a questionnaire. It asks you tons of questions about your character, even like what's their favorite color, you know, what kind of car do they drive, things like that. Things that you're not necessarily going to put into the story, but things that are very important for the author to know. And I think it's always the struggle when you're creating a character of like, what do I need to tell the audience? What does the audience need to know? And what about my character do I need to know and I keep to myself, right? What part of what I'm learning about my character will it actually advance the story? But one of the ways that I create character is I spend a lot of time thinking before I start writing, and then sometimes I'll play with different points of view. So I'll start writing, I write my second novel all in third person. But when I was really stuck on a character for a while, I started writing in first person, just so that I could get an idea of what this character's voice would sound like, and then I went back to third person. But it really helped kind of unclog my, I just couldn't get him right on the page, and that kind of gave me a little bit of inspiration and helped me move forward with him, with this particular character, who was very different than me. Like, oftentimes, we're writing characters that are like nowhere near, you know, one of my characters in my second novel is Roma, so we would know that as a gypsy is kind of the derogatory term, and he's also albino. Obviously, I'm neither of those things. So how do I get into his life? How do I understand what things were like for him? And I feel like you really have to find a point of connection with your character. So for me, I made him a musician and I made him a fiddler. And I played violin in high school. I was like last chair. I was the person that was sitting off the stage. My mom said oftentimes she couldn't even see me. Like I was like in the wings, I was that bad. But I know how to play the violin, and I made him play the violin. So we have that point of connection, and it kind of helps me get into his character more, if that makes sense. So having something in common with your character is, I feel like, very helpful as well. So, great question. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We're down to just the last couple minutes before the bell is about to ring, and these guys are all headed off to their next class. So I'm going to ask them to give you a big round of applause and thank you for your time.
And also for taking the time to ask such thought-provoking questions.
Thank you so much for giving some time to us today. We really appreciate it, appreciate all of the great advice that you've shared with us, and we look forward to that next book when it's finished. Thank you.
Thanks, and I'll send those links along so you can share them with everyone as well.
Sounds
Thanks,
great.
Guys.
Thank you very much.
Take care, and please feel free to email me, any of you. I think I'll pass along my email as well. If any of you have any questions that you'd like to ask me personally, feel free to follow up with me that way too. I love getting emails, so thanks.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye-bye.